morning. Well, as you know, today is Communion Day, so I have to give a fast speech. That's not in my repertoire. The title of this message is, "Any who is athirst, let him come." You find that in the book of Revelation, what Ray just read. What I want you to see is that this is why we celebrate communion. Jesus, in his earthly ministry, was the perfect example of what a follower of God is to be like. He gave everything he had for other people. He was truly selfless. When it came to the end of his ministry, and he saw in front of him the cross, he did not shy away from that, and he did not turn around and go the opposite direction. He told his disciples on several occasions what was going to happen, that he would be betrayed, that they would kill him, but that he would rise again on the third day. The disciples did not want to hear what he had to say, and they couldn't understand how their Messiah could be put to death at the hands of sinners. But what I want you to understand is that Jesus gave his all. And in the end, there was nothing more that he could give.
Amen.
You guys understand that?
Amen.
He gave it all, fully and completely, so that those who are athirst may come, and they may come freely. Has this world quenched your thirst? Has this world fulfilled your appetite? Or has this world left you thirsty and hungry for something more and something better? Something that just can't be filled by all of the material things that we have, or all of the supposedly joys and pleasures that this world has to offer. I can tell you from personal experience, before I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, that there was always, always an empty yearning for something more. That I can, I try to fill it. And when I realized I couldn't fill it, I tried to deaden it. Be quiet. That didn't work either. And when I heard the voice of God calling me through his Son, Jesus Christ, and I gave my heart fully and completely to him, I understood what it meant to come and drink freely. And I understood what Jesus meant when he told the lady at the well, "I will give you water that will quench your thirst, and you will never need to drink again." What this world offered me was packaged really pretty. Looked really good. But when you opened it up, it was an empty box with a really bad odor in it. That's what the world has to offer me.
Amen.
Okay? And when I came to Christ, and I understood that he gave his all for me because he loved me. I didn't even love myself at that time. I hated myself, actually. I could not look in the mirror for a long period of time because I did not like who I was looking at. And I didn't like the person staring back at me. I knew what my mother wanted for me. And I knew that I had not lived up to what her expectations were. And that broke my heart. Until I realized what God's expectations were for me. And what Christ wanted for me. And wanted to do in me and with me. And what I thought broke my heart because of letting my mother down was nothing compared to my heart being broken by knowing what God wanted for me.
Amen.
And that I let him down. Have you been to that point where you know you've let God down? And you wonder, what am I going to do now? You let God down, where do you go from there? You know what I'm saying? But through the ministry of one man. In his personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that that relationship could be seen in everything that he did. In everything that he said.
Praise the Lord, brother.
And how he interacted with people. Now, have you met fake pastors before?
Yeah.
Who say one thing, preach one thing, and live another, and treat people totally different from what they speak? I experienced that. But this man showed me what a true Christian was, and what a true minister of God was, that he cared more for the sheep that God had given him than he did for his own life. And the love that he showed was real and true and could not be talked against, because what can you say? That is selflessness. And I saw it and I wanted that. I wanted to be that guy. But I knew the God that I was. And I told him one day, I can never be like you. He said, you know what? I got good news for you. You don't have to be like me. Because I'm not the pattern. So the pattern is Jesus Christ. And if you give your heart to him, and if you will live for him, you will become like him. Just as sure as you open your faucet and water comes out, as long as you pay your bill. But just as sure as that happens, the more you study Jesus, the more you will become like him. And the more you become like him, the more he will work in you. The more he works in you, the more you become like him. Do you want to change your life? Do you want something better? Do you want something more than what this world has to offer? Jesus Christ is your answer.
Amen.
Had people look at me and go, man, dude, you are so simple. You really believe that stuff? And I look at them and I can tell them with a clean and clear conscience. Not only do I believe it, I'm a living example of it. Because those who knew me in the past can't say anything but, man, dude, have you changed? You are not the same person. And it's because it's not me, but it is Christ in me. This is what the gospel will do for you. If you will continuously, day by day, live for him. Question is, are you doing that? And only you can answer that question. We come to the communion table this morning. We will take the emblems of his spilt blood, his broken body, and we must ask ourselves, do we partake of this worthy? Can we enter his presence with a clear and clean conscience? Is Christ our all in all? Or are we actors playing a part on a stage, hoping that what you see is what you believe and that you'll never know the real? Only you can answer that question. But what you need to know is God doesn't look on the outside. Where does God look? He looks at your heart. What does that mean? He knows whether you got clogged valves and arteries, or he knows what your motives are. See, when it says that God looks on the inside, it's just telling you that God knows the real you. You can hide yourself and you can make yourself appear to be whatever you want in public around other people. But God knows who you really are. And the question is are you comfortable with that? For a long period of time, I was raised, my mother raised us in the fear of the Lord, and I walked away from that. And for a long time, I played a part, And I started to drift away from godly people and surround myself with ungodly people because they didn't care whether I was godly or not. And that's funny because they cared when I became godly. Isn't that funny how that works? When I was ungodly, they wanted me to be with them, but when I was godly, man, I was a drag. You're one of those fanatics. Oh, you're a Jesus freak. And I had to, and it didn't take long, because once I saw what Jesus had to offer, and I saw what the lifestyle I came from had to offer, I realized, yes, I'm a fanatic, and yes, I'm a Jesus freak. Amen. And I don't care whether you realize it or not. I hope you see it in me, and I hope you see that, yes, I am a Jesus freak. I love Him. I've given my heart to Him. And hopefully, one day, I will see it. But you know what? I don't have to hope hard. Like I hope for a new car, or I hope for a new job. The hope that I have, I know will come true.
Yeah.
Because it's based not on me, it's not on what I do, but it's all on what He has done.
Yeah.
If you guys are here next week, turn with me real quick, and this is where we'll close. Turn with me to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4. But you got to see these sets of verses, and I'm going to leave you with a question that hopefully you'll think about all week. You're Seventh-day Adventists, right?
Yeah.
So for some reason, you keep the seventh day and you come to church on Sabbath, right? But this day isn't just one of the 6 days. It's a special day. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
You do different things on this day. Is that correct? And the question is why? Why do you do this? Why do you keep the Sabbath? Is it because it's the law?
No.
What I want you to see is four Seventh-day Adventists. Have you ever had somebody say to you, you guys are keeping the Old Testament law, that Sabbath was for the Jews.
Yeah.
Have you ever had somebody ask you, show me in the New Testament where the command to keep the Sabbath is? Okay? Well, let's look at Hebrews chapter 4. And I'm going to show you very quickly where God's Sabbath plays into God's grace and salvation in Christ. And you cannot separate the two. They're linked hand in hand. Okay, Hebrews chapter 4. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering, what?
Rest.
That word His, is it capitalized?
Yeah.
Okay. So His rest is God's rest. It says, let us fear lest any of you seem to have fallen short or have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them. Question is who is them?
Israel.
So was the gospel preached to them?
Yes.
What's the gospel? The same gospel that brings us to the communion table today. The gospel was preached to them, they rejected that gospel, and because of unbelief they did not enter God's rest. What's God's rest? The set of verses continue on and bring you back to creation on the seventh day God rested.
Amen.
Why did God rest on that seventh day? Was He tired?
No.
Did He need to refresh Himself?
No.
Do you realize that God worked for 6 days and then rested the seventh? Right?
Amen.
Not because He was tired, but because it says at the end of the 6 day, God looked at what He had made and saw everything He made, and it was
very good.
What'd you say, Ricky?
Very good.
The only place in all of the creation story that you find it very good. That means it was perfect. Nothing could be added.
Amen.
Wow.
Complete. Okay? It was done. It was complete. Sabbath is a memorial to creation, right? You're Adventist. You've heard that before. I just don't know if you've seen this linked before, right? So the Sabbath is a memorial of creation because God in 6 days made everything and on the seventh day rested. What did He do on that seventh day? He blessed. And what's the next word?
Sanctify.
What does sanctify mean, Ricky?
To set apart.
To set apart for holy use.
Amen.
Not just to set apart, but to set apart for holy use.
Amen.
Right? And so God blessed that day and set it apart for holy use. Now let me ask you a question. Was there a Jew alive at that time of creation?
No.
Here's another question for you. Was there a sinner walking the face of the earth when God blessed and sanctified the seventh day? So if Adam and Eve never sinned, would you still be keeping the Sabbath today in perfect holiness?
Yes.
The Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. It's not a Jewish Sabbath. It's not a Sabbath of the old covenant that's done away with. Because if you go to Isaiah 66, it tells you that from one new moon and from one Sabbath, all flesh will gather unto me. Right?
Correct.
Now, let me ask you a question. And I'll leave you on this question. Jesus died what day?
Friday.
Right?
6 days.
He died on the cross. Is that right? And what did he do on the seventh day?
Rest.
Why did he rest? No, he did not rest because it was a Sabbath. He rested because salvation was complete, and it was done, and it was perfect, and nothing more could be added, and there was nothing you could do. He rested, just like at the beginning of creation. Ricky?
When he finished creation, he says, "It is finished." When he died, he said, "It is finished."
The two are tied together. You're not saved by keeping the Sabbath. You keep the Sabbath because you are saved and you rest in God's full and complete salvation.
Amen.
I will preach on this more next week, so if you want to hear more, come. Gary?
And this is what communion is supposed to remind us of.
This is what communion is supposed to remind us of. It is complete, it is full, it is done. Let me ask you one more question. Was your salvation complete and the price paid at the cross or on Sunday in Resurrection Day?
From the foundation of the world.
Yeah, before that, the cross.
When was it done and complete? Jesus had to perform the act.
Cross.
Cross, or was it the resurrection? It was the cross, right? He said it is finished. The cross. Sabbath comes. He sleeps and rests. Now, the Bible says according to the commandment, but he rested because the act was complete. Before the foundation of the world, this plan was set in motion.
Amen.
But it hung in the balance until he went and finished the job on the cross. Is that right?
Yes. But it was God's promise, so it never failed.
So it can never fail. But listen, are you familiar with the sanctuary service? You know, the sanctuary itself was split into the eastern quadrant and the western quadrant, right? Certain things happened in each quadrant. The eastern quadrant represented Christ's ministry here on this earth. What happened in the western quadrant would be his ministry in heaven. Salvation. Jesus had to do something at the cross that fulfilled his ministry here on this earth. Resurrection morning would start the ministry in heaven. Hence you have still the ongoing ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. This is why you're Adventist, right? Okay? All this is tied and linked into Sabbath keeping, which is tied into what you're commanded here in Hebrews chapter 4, which is New Testament, which is just a fulfillment of everything written in the Old Testament. We will now separate, and the men will go into the social hall, the ladies out in the blue door room. Everything is ready. When you come back in, please sit in every other, the ones that have the nice green, is that green or is that?
It's green.
Yeah, the nice green sticker.